so special in the sky that it's actually not happening, especially in the renal arteries, actually in this special population. But also it can happen in iliac arteries, it can happen in arteries going to the brain and also cerebral aneurysms. So really the prevalence can be high depending on which cohort you are looking at. In Mayo Clinic, they're of course getting a lot of referral and questionable cases, they do a lot of angiograms, so they call that very high actually prevalence. About 50% of the established patients also have FMD. But I think there's a little bit of referral bias there. Vancouver, again, registration is the biggest study they have in the world pretty much. So what they do, they screen for the renal and iliac artery FMD while they're doing the angiogram for the coronaries, and then they get the CTA of the head and neck to basically look for any thoracic dysplasia and changes. And coronary FMD is a kind of nice, interesting, you know, phenomenon that has been described lately. That, you know, depending again what you define as FMD, if you define just coronary tetralogy, pretty much in all patients with this disease, some coronary tetralogy higher than what you see in other people. If you are looking dilation and ectasia, a bit more than 0.5%, any irregularity or stenosis, you know, different percentage. So again, coronary FMD has been postulated also to be one of the reasons for people to get the scan. This is actually what fibromyalgia dysplasia looks like in terms of its pathology. So most of them, you get medial fibromyalgia dysplasia, meaning this media actually, if you remember, you have edema, media, and fascia. So you get aplasia in the media, that's about 90%. But also you can get media fascia fibrosis, which is this type here, and also you can get edema fibroplasia. So histopathologically, you can have three different FMDs. But looking at the artery itself, either you can get this bleeding pattern, multifocal FMD, which remember, you're more likely to get this tested than anybody else in your ABIM, because it's a very common thing to be tested for FMD, especially in renal arteries, this bleeding pattern. And really the good thing about it is, despite other type of stenosis where you have problems with the stent, to fix them with the FMD, you just do balloon angioplasty and you cure it. So that this goes away for good in most patients undergoing this angioplasty. And also you can get the focal FMD, which again is less common, but more likely you need to do a little bit of intravascular imaging to make the diagnosis. So what is the management of a scan? Now we talked all about the different types, the physiology, how to diagnose, and you know, we saw a couple of cases. So how could you make the decision of not doing anything for the first case and rush the second case to the bypass and that was a Friday evening? So that's like in a more emergent fashion. So how can we those decisions? So first of all, we should appreciate and realize we are talking about the spectrum of presentation in this patient. So they can have a small MI, normal chest pain, doing okay, and be very stable. So in our lady, honestly, with the presenting diagnosis of a scan, I was kind of okay with doing the angiogram so we can make the diagnosis like 100%, although pre-test probability was about 90%. But even doing anything for that, you know, we're not really interested to do anything. Her chest pain was gone, her point was coming down, and her ear was normal. So if it wasn't because of the need for delivery of the baby in that situation, I think we would just monitor that patient in cardiac ICU, probably for a few more days, maybe a few more days on telemetry unit, put down some good medication and let her go home. And then we evaluate her later on. But because, you know, she had to deliver the baby, we were worried about hemodynamic changes and the stress of the body. We said maybe that tear is going to get worse and there would be a need for urgent bypass. And the best is, like always, have you know, ask for help and have people ready to go. And be a little bit more proactive rather than be reactive. So if bad things happen, I think you have resources to take care of. So again, it's kind of a patient with a stable chest pain for a small amount. You shouldn't leave them alone. But remember, monitor them a few days in the hospital. Don't let them go home really quickly, because as you saw in my second case, it's a dynamic situation and the patient can get better early. Like, you know, and then like, situation, then get worse over time. Next thing you know. A large MI, ongoing chest pain, these are the patients that, you know, you have to define the anatomy and decide about the vascularization, whether PCI or bypass. And a several shock patient, those are the tough ones. Then the patient we have to put out some dynamic support. And there are smaller studies now showing that, you know, probably impeller hemodynamic support, which probably I've seen, is a little bit better than balloon pump. You know, there's small theories that I've been sure to work better. And there's some theory behind it. With the balloon pump, you increase your diastolic pressure and coronary flow. There's a little concern with doing that, you can propagate dissection. With impeller, you don't do that. So, again, there's a little bit of advantage of doing impeller if you need cardiac shock. Again, not the biggest study, so in my thinking is probably you have to make a case by case decision. Cardiac arrest, and of course, it can, you know, kill the patient. I mean, this is one of the known causes of pregnancy related death. So, again, the patients are high risk for death, cardiac arrest, cardiac shock, low ER, left main dissection. This happened in about 7.6% of patients in the Canadian scan registry. Now, I think they enrolled more than 400 patients over a few years. So not very common to get to the end of the spectrum, but almost 1 out of 10 patients will get them. So if you look at the natural history of these patients, most of them, again, female, most of them, they had LAD at least being involved. And the good thing is, you know, the rule of thumb for these arches is that they're going to heal up. So it's not a shrink in time. It's not a fixed, basically, stenosis. It's a dynamic tear. And when the mesenchymal hematoma gets absorbed, the mesenchymal usually goes back to where it belongs, and the mesenchymal heals up. So that's why we advocate for conservative management early on. You don't get that big conservative management from interventionalists, but this is definitely one of those. That you have to be, you know, sometimes be careful of not doing things. I've seen patients that they were taken to the cath lab prematurely with this condition. They put the wire down in the false lumen, and the game is over. You have to put metal, you know, stents ultra the artery in a young patient, and that usually is not a good thing to do. And sometimes, you know, this scan actually came to registry. They did angiogram model, but, you know, they're doing a lot of research. Again, many of these patients, they healed up in about 95% in about a month time. So really, again, if the patient is stable, just conduct the management monitor. If the patient is not stable, especially if left main is involved, then think about, you know, bypass surgery. And if the patient has ongoing, you know, chest pain dynamic compromise, PCI or CABG, again, very difficult to, decision to make sometimes for this patient. If there's more detail, I don't know about details of how to do PCI, if you have to do PCI in these patients. I don't think that would really decide to back to the Russian colleagues. But there are specific things you have to consider when you're doing PCI on these patients, which is a little bit different from the regular angioplasty that we do. Again, in the Canadian registry, you know, most patients, they get conservative treatment, and they define very few of them basically end up meeting with vascularization. most likely conditions are, I mean, you have to put the patient on heparin, you know, blood vessel therapy, even if you don't put a stent. So these patients are tough to make a decision for. So I think everybody agrees that this patient, even if you don't do a stent, if you do a stent, you are committed. You have to put 200 patient therapy to keep the stent open. But if you don't put a stent, you have to put the patient at least on baby aspirin. But remember, I mean, just as a side note, between 325 and 81, there's really no big difference except that there's high risk of bleeding with 325. So there are very, very few niche usages for 325. One is the patient who is just presenting with acute coronary syndrome. So those are the patients that get 325 or four of them baby aspirin. Otherwise, really, baby aspirin has been shown in multiple studies is as good as 325 in terms of the ischemic prevention and without increased risk of bleeding. So you put patients on baby aspirin, let the blood clear away. Again, as been suggested by many people, it's a good thing to do, decrease the shear stress, get the heart rate lower. But, you know, how long to do Plavix? Nobody knows. If they benefit from ACE inhibitor, of course, if the LV dysfunction is present, yes, like another heart rate patient, below yellow. But if not, it's not actually well studied. Statins, if they have high cholesterol, to begin with, has been advocated. Very, very, very tiny study from Mayo Clinic, the statins, in an observational study, actually increase the harm to this patient population. I think it's something to consider, but I don't know why. We don't know why. But, again, if the cholesterol is high, they benefit from the statin. Remember, pathophysiology is different. So that means, you know, thinking and how to make a decision of medication is going to be different. You can't just use the same model of visual ACS for this patient population. Not that happens, like, especially if they have chest pain, are good things to do. So they say if they diagnose a patient with a scan in the cath lab, they just stop the heparin. So it's okay to do it until you don't know exactly if it's a scan. But if you diagnose a scan, the patient says not heparin, just because again you're dealing with a hematoma. And theoretically, if you put the patient on heparin and keep the aspirin and all that, you can make the hematoma worse. Is it true or not? No randomized clinical trial. So again, another area that if someone is really interested to put the registry together and do a small study of this, would be good to do. PCR outcome, the other reason not to jump on and do PCR discussion is that the PCR outcome is not so great. So again, you know, these patients, these registries, there's only a good operator, so I mean, you know, as far as your activity publishing, the central morbidity rate was 5 to 6%. That's actually very high. Nowadays, our central morbidity rate for usual PCI is more towards 0.5%. So that means it's like 10 times at least higher in the staff population of central morbidity rate. And remember, these are young patients, so they get a central morbidity, you have to protect it and then just a vicious cycle. So no rush to do PCI unless you have. Another reason not to do PCI is the risk of catheter-induced dissection. So if any of you is interested and later I want to do research on the scan and you go to the ICD-9 code and all that, another common thing that sometimes happens is the guide catheter or diagnostic catheter going in and cause dissection of the artery. And those things get coded as coronary dissection. But those are not what we're talking about today. Those are different entities. Most of them we have to put the standard fix. But the spontaneous coronary dissection that we are talking about today, they do need PCI in all cases, and actually doing PCI can put the patient also at the risk for catheter-induced dissection. Okay, we talk about wiring and how it can be challenging. If you send a patient for bypass, what kind of bypass you do? Vein grafts, lima, which is arterial graft, which we use in most patients that they go for bypass, at least for the LAD. Nobody knows, again, not really studied which kind of bypass graft to do, but for our patient, we actually decided to do vein graft because of two theoretical reasons. One of them was that, again, they remember the natural history of this disease in healing. So even if you put a bypass graft to get the patient out from the acute setting, this native vessel is going to heal up in about a month, 2 months, 3 months. And usually when the vessel heals up and you have a bypass graft attached to that graft, the flow of the graft is going to be slowly, it's going down and the graft is going to close up. So really doing the vein grafts in this patient population is kind of a bridge to healing of the native coronary artery. So it makes a little more sense than using the lima graft from somebody who is young and may eventually need that lima graft later on for a true atherosclerotic lesion. And the other theoretical reason was that lima graft has a higher pressure in it, and again, there's a small risk to propagate the dissection because of hydraulic pressure. Again, no one has shown which one is better, but these are things to keep in mind. And in this patient population, again, just the younger, you know, a good job, but that's really good, but as I said, vein graft is food, and the reason behind it is native vessel heals up. So if you see a patient that goes for bypass surgery, not because of a scan, just usual coronary artery disease, and graft actually closes off, one of the reasons that can happen is that they grafted an artery that didn't need to be grafted to begin with, like there was enough flow in that artery and you grafted it, and you had a low flow in the graft, so the graft would go down. So this is what's going to happen in these patients with graft eventually. So again, it's a bridge, basically to recovery for these patients. Other things, so the exercise, of course, you know, there's a lot of concern by doing, you know, intense exercise activity, increasing shear stress, you can actually make things worse in a patient where they had a scan. So really, what they came up with, you know, because of many advantages of exercise, any patient who gets a stand where they have the mind, I send them for cardiac rehab, most of them they go through and they love it. I mean, they get their strength back for one thing. And the second, they get their confidence back of being able to do exercise. Most people after a heart attack or stand, they get so scared that they don't do much just because they avoid having a heart attack. But if you put them through a cardiac rehab program with a monitoring, intensive situation, they do time actually they don't actually have the trip right now, many years ago. And they took suggested there to get the cardiac sugar. So I assume that you know something serious going on. Second time around, she had a corner CTA which we reviewed. There was no evidence of a silent analysis of infusion. But again, remember corner CTA is not as good as invasive sugar to diagnose. My personal feeling is that patient was kind of hard jealousy. I mean, she got a couple of times pretty warning. So the third time being back to the clinician, she did very, very well. But things would be very bad. So remember, I remember she had a time with her surgeon about this patient, and he just actually told me he had a similar case about a couple of months ago and didn't do very well. So I mean, this can be very, very tough patient, so just be ready for it.
Thank you.